One day we're going to tell about Boyfriend in a Box. That story came out of Wichita, Kansas, same as my good friend Jonathan Coachman did. But now I want to transition to the best sports bettor in the freaking world. To give you an example of what can happen, a lot of guys tout a bunch of BS about what they can or can't do. We decided to put real money to the test. I took my account last week and took the average bet, which is the average bet for sports bet, right at $50. And after 1 week, I had made $667. I had $766 to start with. I made $667. That's a 13 position gain, just over. And ended up with $1,433. The man responsible for this, at least one of the men responsible for us, he is the legend. He is the best in the world. He's our friend, Steve Maltepe's the Philly Godfather. Welcome, Godfather.
Man, we set off some fireworks for July 4th weekend, didn't we, John? It was an amazing week. Everyone made a ton of cash. We had a blast down the shore in Atlantic City. So it was just a good time, man. Everyone made a ton of cash.
I didn't pop any fireworks, but I popped a bunch of cold beers. And from what I heard, I had a great time on July 4th. And apparently, when I was quite inebriated, I learned how to add. Because I said that this next man was 4-0, 2-2, 2-0, successful weeks. And I said that was 8-4. Mr. Joey Odessa, the best combat sports handicapper in the world, that math doesn't add up, does it?
No, it sure doesn't, JB. Good to be here. Get that abacus out.
He was 8-2.
8-2.
Terrible. You know, the problem is concussions. I blame football injuries. Pretty soon I'll be hunting Easter eggs I just hit.
So anyway. 67% wasn't bad, though.
No, 67% wasn't bad, but 80% is a lot better, and you're the best in the world. So
no doubt.
Joy, we want to get right to you because the big news right now, crazy things going on with UFC 251 Fight Island. Tell us about the big news and the main event.
Well, you saw these cancellations at the Apex in Vegas. I mean, Dana White put together those cards in Vegas to get sports rolling again. Well, there was 6 cancellations last week, and right now there's 4 cancellations. But the one that's getting all the press, the main event. Jorge Masvidal is stepping in for Gilbert Burns now against Kamaru Usman. 6 days, short notice. He's got to pass a bunch of his tests and things like that to make this go through. I mean, it's signed, it's sealed. But it's not delivered yet. We won't know if it's delivered until Saturday because, you know, all kinds of hiccups take place. What's interesting, though, we got 2 undercard bouts here. And the one of the two, this Max Holloway, is fighting Alex Volkanovski again. And the last time they fought, Max was a 2-1 favorite. Now Alex is a 2-1 favorite. But earlier in the week, Max had gone public on, you know, several social media platforms, said, look, I haven't seen my trainers for weeks, you know, and I also, I had some quotes for him. I heard him talking. He said, I've got 5 belts in my closet. I'm going to go out there. You can't take that away from me. It's just another fight to me. I'm still a champion. I don't know. To me, that doesn't sound like confidence. That sounds like I'm going to give it a good old honest try and go out there and win. That number, you know, coincidentally went up to like minus 250. And now it's lingering right around minus 250. Alex won the first 3 rounds last time. Max won the last 2. I don't think Max is going to pick up where he left off. I think that Alex is going to go out there, close the show on him, and keep his title.
Let me ask you this. Sorry, Jimmy. I want to jump in. But when you talk about that, and it's all about heart and how much he wants it, Jorge Masvidal does want it. He's wanted Usman for a couple of years. This is his first world championship shot, but he only has 6 days' notice. How has the line moved in the main event? And how do you think people, because they love Jorge so much, are going to start betting on this as opposed to when Gilbert Burns was in there?
Well, I saw minus 240 on Usman right out the gate. As soon as, pretty much when they announced it, but you couldn't bet anything on it. I mean, the limits were tiny. I caught some at minus 275. It's up as high as like -3.25 right now. But here's the thing with this fight, and you're going to see this a lot. People, you know, you've got these 2 main events, and people have the, and I call it loser mentality. You're gonna go in there and you're gonna say, well, I'm gonna grab both underdogs in the main and co-main event, and I'm looking to split. That's loser mentality. I want to win everything. I think that both these favorites are gonna get it done. As far as Masvidal, I mean, he's motivated. He's got a ton of heart, you know, just like Max. But Jorge's also got 13 losses. I'm sure he felt the same way in his other 13 fights because he gives an honest effort every time out. So I think he's gonna walk out of there with loss number 14. You know, it's just short notice, so he's got a built-in excuse, not that he'd ever make one, but we're going to look at this fight and look back and say, look, you know, what if Jorge had a full camp? I don't think it really would have mattered anyway. I think that Usman gets it done.
Yeah, but not only a full camp, Joey, Jorge is having to fly halfway around the freaking world. I mean, this isn't just 6 days' notice. He's got to take all these COVID tests. He's got to fly halfway around the world just for that time change once he gets there and then set himself up in a world-class fight. Does that not factor in the travel as well? I mean, you know, you talk about coast-to-coast travel in baseball or basketball, back-to-back games. This seems to be a lot worse, is it?
I think they're all going to suffer from the same thing. Usman is leaving late, too. I would have expected these guys to get there earlier, but it's Fight Island. They have like a safe zone, kind of like the Olympic Village, except they can't leave it. And it's only people that have tested and continually get tested. The meals aren't quite what they're used to, from my understanding. I know some of the journalists have been complaining about it. They haven't been able to get out to, because I guess they have like regular vendors there of some sort where they could get the kind of fast food or whatever it is that they want. They can't seem to get that in the first day, the quarantine, because these guys are being quarantined out there. I believe they have to stay 24 hours on lockdown before they can even enter into the safe zone. So I think they're all going through a lot of different dynamics. But, I mean, when it comes down to it, two guys step in the octagon and, you know, one guy's going to walk out of there winning. I think that's going to be Kamaru Usman.
But, Joe, anybody that listens to this show has listened to you say that over time, a certain – like ESPN, for instance, they love Jorge Masvidal. They're showing his – it was actually 1 year ago this week that he knocked Ben Askren out in whatever it was, 8 seconds, one of the greatest knockouts of all time. And it gets the public to really fall in love with a certain fighter. And I believe that ESPN, because they love him so much and they really don't know that much about MMA and UFC, that they're going to make bettors fall in love with him all over again. Do you agree with that?
Oh, sure. I mean, the whole purpose of these preview shows is to make every matchup look like a toss-up. And I think there's plenty of footage. I mean, they're going to replay that Masvidal KO of Ben Askren over and over and over. His knockout of Darren Till over and over and over. Two bouts that he was not supposed to win. I mean, if he goes out here and, you know, three's a charm, if he goes out here and pulls this off, even though the number's only -3-1, you know, Usman's only a 3-1 favorite, I think this could go down as one of the bigger upsets in the UFC in the past, you know, maybe the past decade, because the number, I don't think, indicates the skill level and the short notice. I just don't think it reflects that properly.
Hey, Joey, before we move on, I don't know if you handicapped the second fight between Rocky and Drago, but Rocky said in that, he goes, I don't need sparring anymore because I'm Rocky Balboa. It worked really well for him in that movie. This is one of the dumbest things I've ever heard with Holloway. This is ignorant to say that you don't need sparring. You're stepping in there with a world-class fighter in a world-class fight. Have you heard of anything like this ever happening before? Does this not alarm you as a sports bettor if you were to put some money on Holloway before this, if you could have?
I mean, I've heard it, you know, I've heard it before a lot in boxing and things like that. But those guys are guys that I'd normally fade. That's information that would make me want to bet the other side. You know, I think that, you know, him not being on the mat, you know, grappling, him not being, you know, sparring partners, not getting hit, I think it's going to come as a big, you know, look, he's been hit a zillion times. And, you know, he's been in some wars. So I'm not going to say he's not used to it. But at this point, again, I think he's taking his foot off the gas a little bit. You know, when you get comfortable and say, well, I've accomplished this, I've accomplished – when you start looking in the rearview mirror, as I call it, about what you used to do as opposed to what you need to do, I think that's a red flag. And I'm not saying that it's going to, you know, it's not going to cash every single time. But in this instance, I think that Max is kind of, I don't want to say content, but I don't see a hungry Rocky Balboa, as you said, looking for a title here.
And Joey, one last thing, 4-0, 2-2, and 2-0. Yeah, that's 8-2, right?
Last I checked, yeah.
80%. 80%.
That's why these guys are the 1%. Hey, me and Coach are just hosts. We're just hosts, Coach.
We just fire. Yeah. That's all we do.
Like Wider.